Well, praise the Lord. Amen. We're glad to be in the house of God tonight. Thank you so much for being with us, those in-house and those who have joined us on live feed. Thank you so much for being with us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. If you have a prayer request, if you're in-house, you have a prayer request, let it be known by lifting your hand. God knows every need. If you've joined us on live stream and you've got a prayer request, text the keyword prayer to 205-642-8744 because we want to definitely partner together in prayer. Let's all stand, those that can. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask God to touch and minister in our service tonight. Amen. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, again, thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this great opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship and praise you. Father, tonight, I pray you'd move and minister in a mighty way in our Bible study, in our time of Bible study tonight, in our classes, our kids' class, our teens, young adults. Father, I pray that you would move and minister to every heart, every life that's represented. Father, I thank you for what you're doing in our midst and what you're going to continue to do for each and every one of your children. And Father, I thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise and let's worship tonight. Amen.
Your head. the Lord. If you'll get your hymn book now and turn to page 120, we're going to pick it up a little bit and sing Victory in Jesus.
Love is through him. He plunged me.
Amen. Aren't you glad that we have victory in Jesus? Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Again, we do appreciate you being in the house of God with us this afternoon. Have you ever had a phone conversation or a conversation in the middle of Walmart or might be kitchen table, back porch, whatever the case may have been, and the conversation starts off and it goes something like this. It'll say something along the lines of this. Got a phone call the other day. This is part of the phone conversation, okay? Got a phone call the other day, and they told me, somebody was telling me what so-and-so did, and that so-and-so done this, and so-and-so is mad at such-and-such because Sally did this to George, and George done this to Jim, and everything went downhill from there. You ever had those conversations? How about you have a conversation that goes something like this? Well, I was talking to Sister Nellie the other day, and she was telling me that Sister Sarah is going to do this, this, and this. Now, that first one seems more like probably along the lines of gossiping, because they've got a whole lot of people and a whole lot of stuff and a whole lot of things going on. Just sort of seems that way. The second one, well, I was on the phone the other day with Sister Nellie, and she said that Sister Sarah is going to come over and help pick up sticks in the front yard. That don't really, now Sister Sarah didn't say that, so y'all just don't. Don't anybody go over and ask her if she's going to pick up sticks in your front yard, because she's going to tell you no, okay? Kidding. The second one's not really much of a gossip, right? It's just Sister Nellie said that Sister Sarah's going to come over and pick up some sticks. Here's the problem, and I know that's picking up sticks. It sounds like it's a right now thing, right? Sounds like it's a right now thing. It doesn't seem like it's going to be down the road. But you could use this analogy for anything whatsoever. Use this example for anything whatsoever. It seems inconspicuous. It seems like it's mundane. It seems like there's nothing wrong with sharing the information, because all that was shared was from Sister Nellie was, is that Sister Sarah's going to come pick up sticks. That's all that was shared with that, right? And so it seems like this is a pretty mundane, pretty innocent, pretty everything conversation. Where the problem comes in is when it's more than just picking up sticks. Let's say that there was more to this. It's not really much of a gossip thing. It's more of, you don't have all the information to that. So we're going to go back and we're going to stay with our analogy of picking up sticks, because I want to stay very, very innocent in everything. Don't want to throw anything out there that would try to, you know, anything else. But it's so innocent. Something so mundane, something so innocent, something so insignificant like picking up sticks. But we forgot the information of, Sister Sarah said, only if it drops below 60 degrees. That ain't going to be this week. Nor next week. Nor the next week. We forgot that little bit of information, but I'm sitting here waiting on Sister Sarah to come pick up sticks, but it wasn't told to me all the information. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, so now I'm going to get really mad at Sister Nellie, because she's the one that told me that Sister Sarah was coming to pick up sticks. Should I get mad? No, there's information that's left off. There's information that we don't have. And here's where this is going to go into this tonight. James chapter 4, verse 12. Here's what happens a lot of times, and you're going to find this, and I hope that this opens up our eyesight. I hope it opens up our ear. I hope this helps us in a lot of times, because there are times that we receive information. Is Sister Nellie a trustworthy person? Yes. The person, so not just, we're not just saying Sister Nellie, saying anybody. Is that person a trustworthy person? Is the person you receive the information a trustworthy person? Is it a source that you can trust? If the answer is yes, you're going to make the assumption you have received all the info. However, there are times that person may not have all the info. Are you hearing what I'm saying? A lot of times people will make, we're going to go right into this in just a second, but I want to lay a little bit of a foundation as we get ready to read this. A lot of times people will, they don't have all the information. They believe they do. They're sharing that information. We're not going down the road and saying it's a gossip situation. We're staying away from that. It's not gossip. It is factual information. This is something that is straightforward, is factual. However, if Sister Nellie tells me, Brother Andy, Sister Sarah's going to come over and she's going to pick up sticks out of your yard, and then I'm sitting there on the front porch waiting all day for Sister Sarah to come pick up those sticks, she never shows up, I call and chew her out. Who did wrong in that analogy? Why? Because I'm basing everything solely on information I may have gotten from a reliable source. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Brother Andy, what does that have to do with this passage of Scripture? I'm going to tell you something. Okay, yesterday, here's a prime example. I told Brother Emery I was going to come by his house on the way home from Birmingham to pick up something from his house. He got this item available. He got it ready, and it is sitting on the porch, the carport. Is sitting there ready, okay? It was put up somewhere, and now because he knows I'm coming by, I told him that yesterday I had to go to, yesterday morning I had to go to Birmingham. On the way home, I'm stopping by his house to pick this up. Plans changed, and what if I did not have an opportunity to contact him? Now, right thing to do is to contact, and I did. Right thing to do, but what if that's not always the case? What if it's not always the situation? What if it's not always available to do so? The point that we're getting to is this. Sometimes we jump and have what's called a knee-jerk reaction over something, when really we need to make sure we've got all the info before we act on something. Does that make sense? Now, I want you to keep those things in your mind, these examples. I want you to keep that, and I want you to watch this. There's only one lawgiver. There's only one judge. He is he who is able to save and to destroy. Who are you to judge your neighbor? Over the last couple of Wednesday nights, we've talked about the word judge. We've talked about judging one's neighbor. We've talked about judging other people. We do not have that right nor ability to judge somebody else, right? And in that, people will use the word judge to state some things of facts when it actually is not. If I state that you cannot go to heaven with an orange shirt on, that is not factual. That is not. The facts of the matter is that's not in the Bible, right? And where do we place it into the facts of the Word of God that is a factual piece of information? The church world, now I want you to really, please, I want you to really listen to what I'm fixing to say, because some of you that are sitting here, have been raised under some of these things in times past, because we've talked about this, and I want you to really listen to what I'm saying. I'm not disputing things of how your mama and your daddy raised you, but I want you to really listen to what we're saying here, okay? The church world as a whole, over the years, over in times past, had made the proclamation, I heard it multiple times, made the proclamation concerning women's attire, men's attire, the way we part our hair, the way we comb our hair, all of these things, and it has been made that that was tied to our salvation. Don't misunderstand me. There is nothing wrong, absolutely nothing wrong with modest apparel. Amen? I firmly am 100% towards modest apparel. To that end, I'm going to tell you something. I preached one time. I was preaching at a church, as a matter of fact, our former church. I was preaching, and I preached along some items through in the Word of God after service. I had a gentleman come to me, and he wanted to know, when did the Church of God change its teachings? So I wanted to find out what he was talking about. So I asked him, I said, hang out, let me greet folks, let me get these folks out of church, and we got to talk. I need to find out what you're referring to. Gentleman was in, this has been, I mean, I've been here 8 years, so we're going to say this is 10 years ago. And so he was already in his 70s then. And so I asked him, I said, what are we referring to? He said, the Church of God teach, listen to everything I want, because I want you to understand this particular passage and my examples that I just gave. He said, Church of God's teachings has forever been that basically, in order to live a Christian life, long dress, long hair, long sleeves, no makeup. And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not a biggest fan of makeup. I'm not saying makeup is not good. I'm saying that some people needs it and some people needs more. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. No, I'm not. I'm kidding. Now, look, here's the thing that we need to understand. And then he also was talking about how no TVs, no movie theater, no ball game, all of these things. He said, this has always been the Church of God teaching. And so I told him, I said, well, I'll find out. So I called the next day, and I'm not going to tell you that the Church of God is always right. Okay? But that has never been a part of the Church of God teaching. Never. None of those things have ever been a part of the Church of God teaching. So, Brother Andy, does that mean that all of those things are not biblical? Nope. There's nothing wrong with having a TV. The TV can also be dangerous. TV can also be sinful. There's nothing wrong with having a cell phone. But this cell phone can also be sinful. Okay? I've heard this both ways. Now, we're all adults in here. I know that there may be some on live feed that may not be. That's okay, but we're all adults in here. I have heard it both ways. I've heard some folks say women should not dress X certain ways because that makes men sin. And then I've also heard it said, what does it matter how a woman dresses? Men should not sin. Here's the facts of the matter. We all need to not sin. I don't know why it's on one versus the other. There is a thing called modest apparel, modest dress. Hello? And that goes for guys and girls alike. Okay? I've seen guys that have dressed in unmodest ways, and I'm sitting here thinking, Jesus help them. Are y'all hearing me? So what we've got to realize and understand, just because, and y'all know I've used this example, just because I do not own a pair of short pants does not mean that somebody's going to hell because they wear a pair of short pants. okay? What we've got to get is there are things called personal convictions. I don't not wear short pants due to personal convictions. I don't wear short pants just because I don't wear short pants. It has nothing to do with Bible. It has nothing to do with personal convictions. I just don't wear them. That's a personal thing. It's not a biblical thing. Does that make sense? I have people to tell me, look, I've been at Six Flags before, and I had somebody look, and they'll say, whoop, them folks are holiness. And you take a look over, and you look at them, and there's long dress, the long blue jean dress. Y'all know what I'm talking about, okay? And then the bun on the hair and all the whole nine yards. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I can go get the worst prostitute in town, and I can dress them like that. That has nothing to do with their salvation. Do you understand what I'm saying? We've got to realize as our salvation is not about this exterior, it is about the interior. But I promise you, the interior gets right, the exterior is going to line up. Amen? It may take a moment or three, but it's going to line up. Now, all of that being said, we cannot state that in order for somebody to get to heaven, they got to wear a long, long blue jean skirt, because I don't look good in a long blue jean skirt, so that cannot be the case, okay? And I use that because that's a lot of, we've all heard that, we've all heard those things about church, right? That has run more people off from church than it has brought people into church, okay? If every female in this church wants to show up Sunday morning in a long blue jean skirt, I have no problem with that. Chances are they're not. I'm not telling anybody that that's what they've got to wear. Do you understand what I'm saying? All I've ever wanted is modest apparel. I know I'm staying on clothing for a moment, because this is one that I believe literally has run more people from church than anything else. I have been in services where a lady would get saved, and the moment she comes up, four women would come right to her and actually, in the midst of that, make her feel like they're beating her over the head, because she's got to go spend $400 tomorrow on a new wardrobe. That is nothing but a lie from the pits of hell. Do y'all feel what I'm saying? What we've got to realize is our personal convictions are our personal convictions, and it does not give us a right to rewrite the Bible. Does all of that make sense? I'm not knocking anybody that wants to dress in any way, shape, form, or fashion. What I'm saying is we've got to make sure, if you're going to preach that wearing an orange shirt's going to send you to hell, you better make sure it's written in the book and not with your ink pen. Does that make sense? There's only one person that has ever given the word of God, and that was not you and I. It was God himself. There's only one lawgiver, and there's only one judge. When we state, thou shalt not judge, judging is passing that judgment on to somebody else, even though it's not written in the Word of God. Amen? Now, going back to our examples in the very beginning, there are times that we criticize and we backbite and we do not have all of the information. A moment ago I told you that I had already talked to Brother Emery, I believe on Monday, and we was talking about an item that he has at his house. He called me on Monday and he said, I found it. Do you still need it? I said, yes, sir. I said, I've got to go to Birmingham on Tuesday morning. On my way home, I'm going to stop and get it. Did I come by and get it? No. But I had a reason. What if I never called him? What if I never communicated that to him? Does that allow him that opportunity to yell and kick and scream at me because I did not communicate? No. But many times people will do so. Emergencies do take place. But in Opinions chapter 4 and verse 2, common sense and common courtesy still should be survival. Okay? We need to have common sense and common courtesy to make the phone call, which I did. Does that make sense? Am I making sense here? Because I want people to understand, we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. We've got to treat one another like we want to be treated. We've got to interact with one another, and we've got to show decency in all things. But if we all of a sudden start criticizing and backbiting and we don't have all the information yet, amen, we can get ourselves in trouble. Over a couple of Wednesday nights, we have talked about gossiping. Gossiping is not what people think that it is. Gossiping is spreading misinformation that you do not have available to you. We could go into things and we could make up a whole lot of stuff. Brother Emery could have come to church tonight and he could have went over to Brother Larry and said, you know what? That Pastor Byers, he ain't nothing but a liar. He told me he was coming and getting this item at my house yesterday and he never even showed up. He went and he partied and he done this, he done that. He has no evidence that that's what took place. All he knows is I did not show up. Are you seeing what I'm saying? When we start spreading things that we do not know is to be gospel, now we're gossiping. But a lot of times people will criticize and backbite, judge, and destroy somebody because they didn't live up to our expectations, or they did not do what we thought that they should have done, or because Sister Sarah didn't come pick up those sticks. But I don't realize that a piece of info was left off. It was when the temperature drops below 60. Do you see what I'm saying? A lot of times we have information, but more information is always better. And I know that this does not even sound like a biblical study, but this is things that actually affects all of our lives at some point in time or another. Either we've been in the boat or we've done it. I've been in the position of this happening to me more than once, but we've also got to realize we need to give the benefit of the doubt. We need to make sure that we are helping in times of need. We're helping in those times, and we're not causing more trouble and chaos on their lives. I've said this before. We could come to church, and we got to church, and Sister Ida sure was in a bad mood today. She sure was in a bad mood. Well, I don't think I've ever seen her in a bad mood, by the way. We could let her have it because she's in a bad mood. But what would be better? Wouldn't it be better to, we already know she's, we feel like she's in a bad mood. Why don't we do something to cheer her up? Because she must be going through a problem. She must be going through a circumstance. She must be facing a situation. Do you see what I'm saying? And a lot of times, just those little bitty things, it may seem like that's not a biblical thing, that's not something that we as Christians, but that is exactly what we as Christians should be doing. I had somebody come to me one time. It's been probably 20, 25 years ago. I was sitting in the sound booth. I didn't want nobody talking to me. I was sitting in the sound booth at our home church, at my home church. There was doors on both sides of it. I was sitting in the very center of it, so I wouldn't be near one of the doors, and nobody talked to me, and I could stay by myself, and everybody would leave me alone. Nobody did. Everybody came to that sound booth. Everybody opened them doors. Everybody came to check on me. Why? Because I wasn't acting normal. Everybody said, you've got to be having something going on in your life. Something must be a problem. Yeah, there was. I didn't feel good and I want people to leave me alone. I've realized it don't work that way. What we've got to realize and understand is, as Christians, number one, we are very trusting people. Number two, most of us are very friendly people. Number three, we want everybody else to be very friendly. Number four, if you know something, we want to know it because we want to pray about it, but we're really not praying about it. We just want to pray about it. Did that make sense to anybody? Somebody will get you at about 3 o'clock in the morning. What we've got to realize is we are still human beings. We're still, every one of us has personalities. Every one of us has differences in our lives. Every one of us have lives that we live, and all of us are different, but we're one body. We're one family. We're one unit. We're here to celebrate and worship God. And if somebody may be going through a problem or going through something, loving on them is all we know how to do, or all we should know how to do. But trying to pick and try to figure out what the scab is about, that's not what we should be doing. Does that make sense? This is along the lines of this particular verse right here. We are not the lawgivers. We're not the judges. God is the only one that has given the laws. He's the only one able to judge by those laws. And he's the only one that would bring condemnation. But he did not send his son to bring condemnation. Amen? What does that mean? He is the only one that has the authority, but he don't do it. Who are we to bring condemnation into somebody else's life? Does that make sense? We are not here to condemn because somebody's wearing an orange shirt, because they did not show up to pick up those sticks. We're not here to condemn folks. We are here to show the love of God in all things. That is what we're here for. That is why God has created mankind. To show his love to our fellow Christians. What we must understand is when we judge, when we criticize, when we backbite, we're usurping God's right to judge mankind. We're setting ourselves in the place of God, making ourselves God, and claiming the right to sit on the throne in the throne room of God and bring judgment to mankind. We do not have that right. Amen? Now, I want to pause on that because I want you to really understand something else on this. Just because I'm a Christian does not mean I'm a doormat. Amen? Many times people misunderstand that. They hear Christian. When we say Christian, they don't hear the word Christian, they hear doormat. So therefore, Christians are never to get angry. There's a thing called righteous indignation. I want you to understand that. Y'all hear me? Christians are never to get angry. They're never to call correction. They're never to do those things. They're just to just... That's not being a Christian. Amen? When we find our fellow brother and sister and we have found that they have fallen, we're not supposed to try to push them down. We're supposed to help lift them back up. That does come with correction. Biblical correction, not our correction. There is a difference in these two things. Bringing Christian correction to a fellow brother and sister in Christ and bringing judgment that is not backed up by Scripture, there is a difference between the two. Does that make sense? Pointing out, we use the same one, same example, thou shalt not steal. When somebody has stolen something, pointing it out does not mean that the Christian that's pointing out the wrongdoing of thief or thievery does not mean that person is doing wrong if they are doing it in the love of God. Many times people believe that just because we can show the love of God means that we overlook sin, we overlook failures, we overlook moral dilemmas. That is not Christianity either. Overlooking those things, oh, it's okay. God will forgive them and remove that from their lives. That does not help them to grow in God. Amen? If somebody is stealing, some of you remember the man by the name of John Brown. Do y'all remember him? Used to sit right there on that front row. It's been several years ago. It was four. Look, I won't tell all them this. I'll tell you this. There was a man was sitting right there. His name was John Brown. When I first started preaching here, my example was I would always call everything to John Brown. So I had to change that because he was always here. But here's the point. If somebody has been caught stealing, I use this example all the time. I stay on the thieving because, you know, that everybody can understand that one. Thou shalt not steal. And if we catch somebody doing it, if we catch somebody stealing something, and all we do is overlook it, and we don't bring correction to it, what happens? They begin to think it's all right. They begin to think that it's okay to do that. Even the pastor sees them doing it, and he hasn't corrected them, so it must be okay. And they go from stealing small packs of bubble gum to a car. Go on. What we've got to realize and understand is when things happen, we have got to bring correction or people think it's okay. But we're living in a society today that if we bring correction because somebody stole a pack of bubble gum, if we bring correction, oh, you can't judge me. You're not my judge. You can't condemn me. They'll quote, that's the only time people know John 3:17 is when they call that verse out. You can't condemn me because Jesus didn't come to the world to condemn the world. Calling out and bringing that correction is not bringing condemnation. It's bringing correction and bringing reproof. Now, I know some churches have done this. I'm not a fan of this. I'm not saying it's right. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just telling you that Pastor Andy's not a fan of this. I know that there's been times that if somebody in a church was caught doing something, I know a particular person that was a husband and a wife, that the husband was caught having an affair, and the church brought that husband and the adulteress. Is that right? Adulteress, is that right? Okay. And right in front of the whole church and told the whole church, this is what's happening. Now, some people will say, oh, they should have done that. I'm not a fan of that because what happened to his wife that he had the affair on? What happened in her life? She just got embarrassed for something that was not her fault. Does that make sense? So I'm not the guy that thinks that you bring people and you march them right up here and they have to stand right there and you have to and I have to read a whole listing of everything, because I'm gonna tell you something. I don't want to be the person standing there. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? I do believe that we have to give an account for the things we've done wrong in our life. I also believe that there are consequences to our sin. Nowhere in Scripture, if you can find it, please show it to me. Nowhere in Scripture does it state that God forgives the sin and the consequences. Is everybody with me? God can forgive the sin. We may have to pay the consequences, the earthly consequences of that sin. And I'm going to be real with you. I'd rather pay the earthly consequences than the spiritual consequences of that sin. I'm glad Jesus paid the ultimate price for my sin. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? I did not say that Jesus did not pay the price of our sin. So if anybody thinks I said that, I did not say that. If we go rob a bank, staying on our thieving example, we go rob a bank, God can forgive us of that. We still got to pay the consequences of that robbery. Does that make sense? People will throw, y'all, this is, anyway. People will throw grace and mercy around in these passages of Scripture. Do you find the word grace and the word mercy in any of these passages? What we've got to realize is there is grace and there is mercy, and it is found in this, in the fact that man is not rewriting the Bible, God wrote it. We have grace and we have mercy because God wrote the Word of God, not mankind. We've got to realize that. There is a strong, very strong thought process here. God is not going to tolerate someone else setting themselves up as judge over other people. God's not going to tolerate that. God's not going to allow that. God does not entertain that. And when we feel like that is our responsibility to cause ourselves to be judge and juror, as it's said many times, when we feel like that's where we are supposed to be, God will bring us down a notch if we're not careful. Do you understand what I'm saying? We go back to many of our examples that we've used over all these years. You go back to thievery. You go back to clothing. You go back to any of those things. You can apply those things to this passage. One of the biggest ones that people don't want to talk about, especially not in the church world, is gluttony. This happens all the time. I'm not a gluttonous person. I like food, but I also know there's a point that you got to stop. Does that make sense? I like food, but I'm not going to be miserable. I love Debbie cakes, but I, the sound booth just went, I love Debbie cakes, but I also know there's a limit to those Debbie cakes. I need to have a limit on those Debbie cakes, right? What we've got to realize and understand, gluttony is the one sin that not many church folks want to talk about, because we all like to eat. These things apply to all things, including gluttony, but we don't want to talk about the things that we're doing. We only want to talk about what somebody else is doing. God is going to bring judgment to all mankind. I just need to make sure that the blood of Christ has covered my sins, and you've got to do the same. It's not my place as the pastor of this church to take every person and say, okay, these are the things that I see as sin in your life. These are the things I see that sin in your life. That's not my place. That's not my responsibility. It is all of our place. It's all of our responsibility to work out our salvation with fear and trembling before God, so that the Holy Spirit of God will convict us of those sins. Where does that conviction come in? When we walk into the grocery store and we pick up that pack of bubble gum and we put it in our pocket and we think nobody else saw us. A camera might not have seen you. A staff member at that grocery store may not have seen you, but the Holy Spirit of God did see you. It does not matter that nobody caught you. God saw it. And God brings that conviction. But there's so many that have forgotten that conviction power of God. And they yell, "You can't judge me. You can't judge me. You can't judge me." And in actuality, what they're saying is they're saying, "You can't judge me," when it's being done with the love of God. I know that these past five, six Wednesday nights has been talking about one topic and one topic only: judging. This has been a very sore spot in my life for many, many years, because that's what we always hear. I can't tell you how many times I've had people point their finger at me in the church world and tell me, "You can't judge me." I'm not judging anybody. I'm pointing out what the Word of God says. Now, I cannot stand up here behind this pulpit and sit here and say, "Okay, I'm waiting till everybody gets in, and I'm going to say, all right, yep, I see what that person's doing wrong. The Word of God says what they're doing is wrong." That's not showing the love of God. But if God brings His Word through a Sunday school class, through a song, through a sermon, and it pricks our heart, that's not called judging. That's called conviction. Y'all remember the young man that I told you? He came to this church and he sat right there where Brother Larry is sitting at right now. That's the exact seat he was sitting in. When they left here, they went to Captain D's and had lunch. I know that's where they went, because the family called me afterwards. "Sister Sarah, they went to Captain D's for lunch, and this is what the conversation went. Pastor, we brought our son to church the first time this morning. We introduced you to him, and he has sat here and he's told us while we was eating lunch at Captain D's, he told us all about your message, and none of us heard that in your message. He said that you preached on these things, but we never heard those things. And we had to tell him, that's not what you preached on. You preached about Noah's Ark, but he said you preached about this. That you preached about this, but that's never what you said." What that was the Holy Spirit of God touching that young man's life. And that was the translation into his life. I was speaking a foreign language, a tongue, so to speak, and he had never heard it. And it was pricking his heart. What we've got to understand is that's what God is trying to do in all of our lives, saved and not saved, because God wants to change our lives daily. The Bible says we're to take up our cross and follow after him every single day. There should be a change in our lives. There are several things of why we should never try to condemn someone else. We should never criticize someone else. We should never try to tear somebody else down. Because, as we've already mentioned, there are a lot of times we don't know what somebody's going through. We don't know what that's going on in their lives. Brother Andy, you just don't know how ugly and how mean Sister Ida was to me this morning. She was so mean to me. I'm so mad at her. Well, why not stop and pray with her? Not for her, with her. Because she might have been facing something. Pray for it with her. Does that make sense? What we've got to realize and understand is when we start doing that to somebody else's life, there may be a time that we have a bad day. And somebody is going to do that towards us. All people, religious, non-religious alike, all people come short, fail, fall the glory of God. No one is ever exempt from sin. I find it very comical, but yet it's very sad at how people that are church folks, they get really, really churchy when somebody that is a sinner comes into their midst. All of a sudden, their nose goes straight up in the air. It's nobody here. It's always at the church down the road, okay? Because we don't like the way they dress, the way they act, the way they talk, the way they smell. They're not one of us. Well, you know what? At one point in time, we was all sinners. We've been saved by the grace of God. And even though we are saved, Sister Nellie, we still can fall short of the glory of God. I can still stumble and I can still fall. Somebody asked me this week, I'll do this in closing. Somebody asked me this week, what is my buttons? What is something that people could push on me that could really get me really going, that could cause me to stumble and could cause me to fall? What is my buttons? I'm going to tell you what my buttons are. That way you stay away from them. My buttons are mess with my daughter, mess with my wife. Don't misunderstand me. I know that my wife and my daughter are neither one are perfect, and if I wanted them to know that, I'll tell them. I don't need y'all going and telling them I said that, okay? But I do know that both of them are not perfect. And they know that I'm not perfect. And if I needed y'all to tell them, that if I needed them to know that I know that they know that I'm not perfect, I'll tell them. You don't need to tell them. But I was sitting at the Board of Education, Randolph County, and the principal of the school was sitting there. I really don't care if it's on live feed or not. She knows how I feel about this. And the principal of the school looked at me because I had inched closer on the edge of my seat. If y'all ever see me inch closer on the edge of my seat, I'm either very excited or I'm very angry. So you just need to pick which one it is, okay? Most time if it's church, I'm really excited, okay? But I inched very close to the edge of my seat, Brother Wayne. And that principal looked at me and said, now, Pastor Andy, I said, hold up. Pastor Andy is back at that church praying for you. This is Daddy talking right now. Don't pull that pastor card on me right now. Some people say that I'm wrong for saying that. I don't believe that I am, because last time I checked, I'm still a human being. I can get angry and sin not. And I'm not going to lie to you. I get very close to that very edge right there when I get angry. If you mess with my daughter and my wife, in that order. What we've got to realize and understand. I mean, people have spit in my face and I have just sat there and looked at them. I have been hit and I've been sat there and I'll look at them. You can yell at me and cuss me out. I can sit there and look at you. And I got a little stupid grin on my face while you're doing it. But mess with my daughter or my wife. Now, look, I'm saying all those things to bring you back to this. Y'all, we're parents. Grandparents is in this room. Parents is in this room. I did not say we're grandparents. Y'all hear me? I did not say we're grandparents because I'm not a grandparent. I said we're parents. There's grandparents in this room. What we've got to realize and understand, we all have buttons. We all have those things where we can get really, really angry at things. But we also have got to realize we're still the children of God. And in all of those things and everything we do, we need to use God's love in every aspect of what we do for the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. There's so many more verses here in chapter 4. We're going to start the next chapter. We're going to start the next thing next Wednesday night, because I'm going to tell you something. This particular topic is very, very dear to me, because so many people use it in the church world the wrong way. Okay? If you've gotten nothing out of the last five Wednesday nights, six Wednesday nights, get this. Look up the word judge before you start using that word. That right there sums everything up in a nutshell. We need to know what we're talking about. Amen. Live feed, thank you so much for joining with us. Join us back Sunday school Sunday morning at 9:45. Worship at 11. May God bless you.